Thank you for joining Heart Center, Inclusive Arts on the Same Stage.
That's good. We're on the same page.
Okay. This on-demand video webinar features artists, art instructors, and allies to the deaf and disability arts community. In this video, Heart Center in Kingston, Ontario shares stories of local professional artists and their experiences working on arts projects with deaf artists and artists with disabilities. The webinar will introduce Heart's award-winning MixAbilities Inclusive Arts Training Program that benefited from consolidating those many years of experiences and our current best practices. In short interviews, the artists will discuss from all perspectives, as allies, some of the existing barriers that prevent full participation in the arts, arts training, and arts opportunities for people with disabilities and the deaf. In addition, as our nation ages, artists will speak to the reality of how more and more people are experiencing barriers to participation in the arts. Collectively, we recognize this video is from the perspective of allied artists and arts instructors. Its intention is to encourage the wider arts community to move beyond current practices towards a spirit of full inclusion. Overall, Heart Center hopes that this video will inspire you to learn more, collaborate more, and start incorporating what you've learned in your next workshop or class to make way for the deaf artists and artists with disabilities. At the end of this video, we'll have lots of resources and credits, and you'll be able to connect with the artists that are in the interviews by contacting the Heart Center. Almost 25 years ago, I came to Kingston from Ottawa to take a break from 20 years of a great career as a professional printmaker and a painter. Most of my work is a story, it's impressionist in style, and often is done as a series in acrylic and ink. During those 20 years, I was inspired by a young man who had a great sense of self, loved to laugh, loved to be the center of attention, and was quite able to critique my work. He also had an enormous sensitivity to those who needed help, and oh yeah, he had Down syndrome. For youth like him, access to post-secondary options were and are very limited. So when he came to visit, I set up painting workshops for him to meet and socialize with people he could relate to. Didn't take long before Heart Center grew from 2 rooms to over 10,000 square feet. Annually filled with local and national professional artists that are neurodiverse, neurotypical, deaf, and with disabilities, all thriving in 3 different accessible spaces, collaboratively mixing skills, opportunities, and every day advancing ideas that need to be explored. I love this work. But it takes training and understanding to consolidate everything we've learned. And we keep evolving. And at this point in the video, I'd like to introduce Andrea Fitzgerald, who has worked alongside Karen Dolan, to explain just how our mixed abilities training works.
I'd like to welcome everyone to an introduction to our mixed abilities inclusive arts training. Since 1998, Heart Center has introduced hundreds of volunteers, post-secondary placement students, contract artists, and arts educators to our inclusive arts approach. It's been such an important part of the work that we do to bring everybody in our community together and to join in an inclusive arts approach since Catherine first opened the doors of Heart Center 25 years ago. Going back a few years to 2016-2017, former board members Bonnie Henderson and Peter Wolf, both educators themselves, suggested that it might be time to look at formalizing the training that we've always done and making something that was standardized to us so that everybody coming through our doors would get an idea of what we do and how we do it to empathetically and effectively support all of the artists that we work with here at the Heart Center. And that is essentially how the MixAbilities training program was initially born. This 6-module training unit reflects more than 2 decades of experience and input from artists that we've worked with, from our staff, and it's provided a framework for us to help new community artists, new staff members, volunteers, and placements increase awareness of our mission and vision, effectively and empathetically support artists who are deaf or who have disabilities as they progress on their artistic journey, develop skills and confidence as inclusive arts facilitators, and increase knowledge and understanding about the value of inclusive and accessible arts for both participants and audiences. Because it isn't just about those who are making the art, it's about those who want to enjoy the art as well. In 2018, we were fortunate enough to meet Karen Dolan, who became our MixAbilities Artist Facilitator, and we ran our pilot testing year that year. Karen has been with us ever since, and I've had the great pleasure of working alongside her to deliver our MixAbilities training since that time. In 2021, Karen won the Ontario Arts Education Association Community Arts Educator of the Year Award for her work with Heart Center and the MixAbilities program. She guides our participants in this program through all of the modules and then introduces them to inclusive arts facilitators from our community who are actively engaged in the Kingston area. Some of the artists that she introduces them to have already completed our MixAbilities training, and some are artists who have a wealth of experience that contributed to shaping the materials that created these modules. Others are leaders in the inclusive arts movement with lived experience. As an ally to the deaf and disability arts, HART is continually striving to update and improve our training, because no matter how long we've been here, we know that there is always more to learn and always more to share. So that's why the materials within the modules change as time goes on and have grown to include more topics and more diversity, including modules for artists interested in working with seniors, modules that are more specific to administration and the importance of how administrators can support a shift towards a more accessible and inclusive approach to the arts. Because it's all of us together that are going to make this change so that the arts can be a part of everyone's lives, regardless of ability or disability. And we hope that you'll join us for the rest of this webinar and enjoy hearing from the artists that you will meet today throughout the rest of this video.
My name is Catherine Mackay, and I'm a Kingston-based professional theater director and administrator, and I'm the artistic director of Peerless Productions. 20 years ago, I was invited by HART to direct a new musical called Martadella's Gift, featuring a cast of 20 neurodiverse performers. I balked, saying that while I had a lot of experience as a director, I had no experience working with people with special needs and I wasn't qualified for the job. I was assured that I was being hired as an artist, no special qualifications were needed, and that this would be in a collaboration like any other show I worked on. I was skeptical, but I was eventually persuaded and began working on the production with some pretty remarkable people. In hindsight, I realized that I was just beginning my own mixed training in working as an ally with neurodiverse artists. When I began to work in disability arts, there were few, if any, neurodiverse artists working in theater. So there were few role models or mentors that any of us could look to for advice, techniques, or inspiration. And so my fellow artists and I began to develop our own methodology. I've now directed, co-created, and worked as an ally on 10 productions featuring neurodiverse artists. And while I now feel more confident in my ability to collaborate with remarkable performers, each time I dive in, I'm reminded that there's so much more I don't know. So I ask, collaborate, I build on past performances in order to ensure that I'm not making assumptions about what will or will not work, and I'm continually reading the room. There are many practical things we figured out. Rehearsal periods work best when they continue for just a few hours a day over many weeks. Music is a remarkable tool for helping to learn lines, and new acting methodologies need to be created for each individual performer. But it's a living, ever-changing process. It's humbling, exciting, inspiring, never boring, and these have been some of the most creative productions I've worked on over the course of my directing career. While I did not formally take the mixed training, I hope that in many ways my work as an ally and theater practitioner is a living representation of the philosophy behind this great program.
I'm Catherine Porter. I'm the founding director of the HART Center. I came here in 1998 as a visual artist looking for some exciting things to do and ways to engage people with challenges. 20 years before moving here, I had the honor of working with a young man with special needs. And then he used to come to visit me in Kingston, and I created an opportunity to engage other people like him. What I've done and developed is a formula where I create a theme, and once that theme's established, I find as much information and resources to reinforce that theme so those with challenges, neurodiversity, in particular can hold on to and use as the starting point to create a beautiful piece of work. I'd ask them to demonstrate how they thought this piece of work would look like by either using their hands or drawing or speaking or whatever way that their ability allowed them. Then after that, they would create a full colored sketch and work towards a finished product. The finished product was absolutely amazing and diverse as the individual was, so nothing was ever excluded. It was always applauded. Setting limits, though, on mediums and color choices and materials was good for budgets, but it also limited limited the exploration time and allowed us to keep moving forward on any projects for timelines. The other big thing that I found was having a color wheel enabled the artist to choose image or colors that they liked and then recognize that they were repeating the same color or mixing too many things together. And the end result was supporting a fresher image, something that was clean. The last thing that I would suggest to anybody working with individuals with neurodiversity or challenges is to also invite them to plan for a goal, whether they are going to complete works for illustrating a book that somebody else has written within other workshops, or props for a play or a performance, or their own solo exhibit, because they're all very capable. And I'm humbled by some of the work that they do. So as a visual artist, working with people with challenges, find a theme, find something that everybody agrees to, and then find the resources and then enable them to do what they do best, and that's be original.
So my name is Kathy Chow Switzer, and my career has been a special education teacher in the elementary range, but I've also taught adults for many, many years with special needs. And I'm also a musician, a violinist, a former violinist in the Kingston Symphony and in a string quartet called Quartessence. I was working as a special education teacher and in the elementary panel, and a large part of my work had to do with integrating, supporting students integrated in their regular classrooms. And because music is my passion, I thought I could do more in supporting them in their music classes. And so I applied for a grant from our board to purchase ORF instruments. We didn't have any at our school at the time. I love the ORF approach. I started taking courses in ORF just because. And as soon as I started, I thought, I just became excited because I could see its application and how ideal it was for our neurodiverse population. And so, I wanted the students to be able to not just be present and witnessing their classes. My friend had referred to this as the illusion of inclusion, but to actually be engaged and access the musical concepts that were being taught and be creative and produce music. And so the ORF instruments, having them with me, I could incorporate them. I could practice with the students outside of the classroom based on what was being taught in the regular classroom. And then they could actually participate much more fully during their experiences. And certainly with the musical productions at heart as well. I mean, the arts, I would say in the past, individuals that were neurodiverse and considered special, the arts wasn't an area that was particularly focused on and developed, even though many loved music and loved moving to music. But to actually be taking programs in music and studying music and learning skills in music wasn't, it was more you know, other types of life skills activities that would be a bigger focus. And I think the arts gave people, empowered them. They gave them a voice and gave them a vehicle for expressing themselves in ways that we haven't heard before.
All performers get nervous, go for it.
The outcome will be rich with discovery, rich with accomplishment, and also some delightful surprises.
Today we will be showcasing a number of projects from our students here at Hart. They were not only produced, but actually designed, choreographed, written, and produced by our students, which is quite amazing.
Well, my name's Holly Gwyn-Timothy, and I'm the artistic director of Melos Choir and Period Instruments. So that's an early music group. My vocal training is predominantly classical. But in the course of undergoing a near injury in around age 20, with overly aggressive operatic training, I uncovered the functional vocal methodology of Cornelius Reid, and just began to study that in earnest, and it completely freed up my voice, and then I began to teach that method. So it's, my background was focused on other singers and performers. Over time, I had the gift of being exposed to people who were really vocally compromised, and I began to find that this method worked equally for them as it did for regular performers, and that really caught my interest. So I like solving problems and helping people. So I've been working with compromised voices, and that can be anything from, you know, post-stroke patients, public speakers who strain their voices, people with who've been through cancer and have had large portions of their lungs removed. That's I've been doing that for about 30 years now. My husband and I have had 4 children, one of whom has Down syndrome and is incredibly musical. And when he was born, I was told by somebody in the NICU that he would never be able to sing because people with Down syndrome can't sing. So at that point, I resolved, that's it. This person is so wrong and I'm going to prove them. So I had a good spur to always be looking for a chance to get somebody like my son singing. And then I moved to Kingston, again, another gift, discovering Heart Center. And in fact, it was one of the reasons we moved here with our family, knowing that this school was here. As an aspiring artist with ability to work with a variety of people who haven't had the advantages I have, has helped me heal. And it breaks that two-way street of isolation, the contagiousness of isolation.
My name is Isadora Spielmann. I was trained in Austria, in Vienna, in a school for any kind of fiber art and work. It was a 6-year program in which we learned custom sewing, pattern making, design, costume making. We worked with leather, we worked with embroidery, we worked with spinning and weaving. We had to learn everything from the silkworm to the fabric. Where does the fabric come from? Where does the fiber come from, I mean? And what to do with it and how to treat it and what to go on. I search out and I try to figure out, first of all, what the skill of the participants are. And fine motor skills are very important when you hold a needle. So we start with large needles and large canvas and work our way up to finer materials. The ability as well as the creativity of the participants are important. And I watch out for what the person can do, where they feel comfortable, what they like to do. Give me a design, draw out what they can or how they see what it will be. And then I try to cut out as true to their design as possible. And then first of all, of course, show them how to go about it and set them up and let them work. And then I give them suggestions of what materials we could use or how we could tackle a certain aspect of their work, and they have, of course, the free will to say, yes, I like this, or I don't like this, and then we go about it, and the results are usually quite wonderful and quite a bit surprising to everybody, and very makes them happy and gives them a great sense of accomplishment. And
I'm Amy Booth. I'm a former dancer. I grew up training in classical ballet at the Royal Winnipeg Ballet School. And then I became a dance teacher in Toronto, and very interested in, continued to be very interested in how the body moved. So that led me to a career in physiotherapy. And I wanted to mesh my two worlds, my love of dance and my love of helping people move better. So I began to bring arts to more vulnerable communities and started a Dancing for Parkinson's program in Kingston. My work with Parkinson's disease started, I guess, several years ago. I was introduced to the idea of the Dance for Parkinson's program through a program in the United States called Dance for PD. They had a wonderful training through the organizers of the Mark Morris Dance Group, and they brought that training to Toronto. So I was working as a physiotherapist at the time and was really excited about this idea. So jumped into learning more about it and the benefits that a dance class can offer someone who's living with Parkinson's disease. So one of the challenges in getting people to come to my program was that it's a dance class. And there is a huge misnomer that people who might be using a mobility aid or might be using a wheelchair can't dance. And that's something that I've been trying to fight against this whole time and let people know that everybody can dance, and dance can be for every person in their own way. And in the long-term care homes, I think that's another area that we can think, oh, this person isn't moving or talking, they're not going to benefit from being in a dance class. And again, I would challenge that and have artists bring in to their group anyone who wants to be there, even as an active listener. With individuals living with dementia, sometimes playing a beautiful piece of music that reminds them of something in their past can bring them into the present for a moment, and you can see that change in their eyes. And just being able to simply move and have them follow your movement or hold on to a scarf with you and sway to a song can be hugely beneficial, and you can leave knowing that you touched them in some way and potentially added a little bit of joy to their day. One of the biggest challenges in long-term care, I think, is actually gathering people into one space. So many of the homes are set up with corridors of rooms and then a communal space that people have to be transported to. And certainly in units where people are living with dementia, many of them are living in a wheelchair, not able to walk. So it requires a personal support worker or a nurse or a staff member of some kind to come and bring them to the program. So that takes a lot of time and a lot of organization. I would come in some days and people wouldn't expect me. They wouldn't have remembered that I was coming. So that's another challenge as well, making sure that artists call ahead and are really advocating for their program, helping gather people into the space, making sure that they are respecting the hardworking staff around them, but also helping to gather them, yeah. I think one of the most important things that I can say to someone jumping into this very, very exciting line of work that is so meaningful is to plan so that you can improvise. The classes are not always going to go as you want them to, but if you have all sorts of ideas hidden in your back pocket, you can pull them out when you need to. Be forgiving of yourselves if it doesn't work, and continue to try, because it is really a worthwhile profession to be involved in. Sharing your passion for your art form with other people is a gift, and improving the quality of life for someone who is close to their end of life is very, very meaningful. And I think one of the biggest things that I found helpful for me as an artist, especially when I was starting out, was reflecting on my practice and taking the time after each program to figure out what worked, what didn't work, ask for help, talk to other people in the industry who have had success, and find out what they do to make it work. Ask the staff about the patients that you're working with, and come in and see them as people, not patients. So remembering that what we do is of therapeutic value, but we're not therapists. We're artists coming in and sharing the love of what we do with others.
That's it. Shake. Shake. Camille Spencer, and I am a dance educator, a choreographer, a teacher, and just a dance advocate. I have worked with the Parkinson's community and have also been working with the neurodiverse population here in Kingston. I have worked with communities both in Australia and in the UK and now here in Canada. In my methodology when teaching dance, specifically, is to keep it a very creative and open environment and not concentrating on specific choreography or specific songs that have an end goal. It's more about the process of being creating in the moment and involving imagination in the creation of movement. Very organic and just getting into our own bodies. Some of the challenges that we face in these classes are our accessibility. Mm-hmm. Accessibility to the different communities is always a challenge. Mm-hmm. Making sure that the studio and the environment facilitate all of their different needs, whether it be medical needs or physical needs or emotional needs as well, and making sure there's not a lot of distractions around, making sure that I also know beforehand information about them, about the participant, and maybe what triggers them or what may cause a negative experience for them. Something that I really like to do and encourage is whenever I have somebody interested in contributing, maybe monetary or in other ways, I always invite them into the classroom. Come into our classroom, come into class, work, come just see the community we have, because the class isn't just for the alternative community, whether it be Parkinson's or neurodiverse. It's for everyone, and it can be an enriching experience for anyone that steps in, because there's many times that I have volunteers saying, wow, that was a great experience for myself. We discount the abilities that different populations have. I think we downplay their ability with the word disability, and I think we underestimate what they can create and how professional they can be, and we ourselves can learn just as much from them as us teaching.
My name is Christine McLeod, and I'm a writer, and I'm very interested in stories and community art of all kinds. So I've written a book of short stories, I've written a nonfiction book, and I'm also a poet. So there's a writer named Muriel Rukeyser, and she says that the world is made not of atoms, but of stories. So I ascribe to that philosophy as well, and that's how I ended up teaching seniors in the Accessible Arts program. And it's seniors of differing abilities, so maybe they can't access regular community programs because as we age, of course, we have different needs related to things like, you know, perhaps you're deaf, or perhaps you know, you've got macular degeneration, or perhaps you have memory issues or mobility issues. There's all kinds of reasons that seniors can't access regular arts programming. Although, of course, everybody can participate in the arts and get a lot of value from it till the end of their lives. I started out being quite, you know, I had a lesson plan, and this is what I wanted to achieve each week. And I quickly realized that this wasn't the way to work with this group at all, and I became less goal-oriented about what we were going to do and more process-oriented. And I really had to become responsive to the people who came to the sessions. Some people had memory issues. The range was unbelievable of people in the room. So some people wouldn't remember me from week to week or the story they'd told. There was another woman in the class who sat beside me. She wouldn't participate in the storytelling, but she liked to read from the book of short stories that I brought in. It was my book of short stories. She really liked to read that. So each week she'd be reading it. And then one week in the middle of our session, you know, there's a bunch of people around the table, we're trying to engage. She says, what's with the cats in that story? There's one story that features cats quite prominent. What's with the cats, she said. And I was a bit distracted, and I thought, oh, I don't really know what she means, but I said, the cats represent something else. And she says, ah, the cats are the Greek chorus. So this woman is completely lucid and has actually said one of the most penetrating things about this story that anybody has said to me. And then there are other people who don't remember from week to week. So that was the big challenge, was trying to find ways to be responsive enough that everybody could participate in the way that they wanted to. The more responsive I could be to the needs of the actual people in the room, and the more flexible I could be, the more the stories just spilled out, and it was a really rich experience for me, for sure, and for them. They really engaged with one another and developed friendships that hadn't existed before our storytelling sessions.
There's this sense of community that everyone is together doing this. Even though everyone might be looking at me and waiting for my instruction, you still have this feeling that everyone around you is doing the same thing, and that you can hear your beat and you can feel your beat, but you can hear everyone else, and it feels like this huge orchestra of buckets or whatever random percussion we found that day and we're using. That's the biggest thing for me, is to get that feeling in them that I can do this and that I'm going to do it, and that it's not even the feeling that they can do it, because they actually can. Sometimes even just having two people share a bucket really brings two people together that I've never seen even talk to each other. And then they're sharing a bucket and they're playing, and they just start a rhythm together, and no one else is even doing anything, and they just start a rhythm, and you didn't instruct it, you had no idea that it was going to happen, and you just take that energy and you just run with it. So I've been doing this for a little under a year here at Hart. So I started off volunteering and just basically hanging out with the guys here. Every now and then, Diane would play guitar and sing with them, and I just thought that was a really awesome idea, and that it was kind of just like this campfire feeling of everyone just sitting around singing. Once I got the chance to kind of sit in for Diane and just play guitar and sing with them, I was like, this is the best thing ever. And then for some reason they noticed my enthusiasm with how much I loved working with everyone here. To develop their sense of rhythm, and develop their sense of timing, and also to develop their sense of belonging together as a community, as a class. We all, as a group, try to create some rhythms together, and so we have to listen to each other and we have to listen to ourselves, but also we're really developing a sense of personal independent rhythm. On the flip side of that, I usually try to end class with just a big group sing-along, but I always try to introduce new songs and new ideas, so that you always feel like there's something that I can accomplish here, and there's something that I'm really going to get out of this, because that feeling is really wonderful when you feel like you've gotten over that hurdle. It's really awesome to see someone who feels like they can't play drums at all, or feels like they can't even play a rhythm, and then even to just get 5 seconds out of them where they're doing a really simple beat or alternating their limbs in a way that they've never actually done before and they've never thought about before. And it's really amazing to see the look on their face when they feel that for the first time, even the second time, and then even every time after that, that it's just, they just light up when that happens, and you can see it and you get excited and they feed off that, and it's really, really a wonderful feeling, I think, for everyone involved.
That was wonderful!
I hope you enjoyed the video, and remember, check us out on the website, and any questions you might have, don't hesitate to call. Hey Megan, anything?
I'm glad to be included, and one day I'll be a great star and I'll hope to inspire others.